So the message is that great design is a very fragile thing, and you as designers have to work to maintain the integrity of your vision. There are more factors in industry trying to kill good ideas than to make them happen. Believe me, there are more people trying to pull the rug out from under your feet than there are to lay it in front of you. Oh gosh, we've gone too quickly there. Let's just go back, sorry. And another example of how that goes wrong, you may have seen this on the internet, I pulled it off. What happens if a great big megalithic company like Microsoft actually starts to apply the way they worked to a company with great vision and singularity of vision, Apple. So this little film came off YouTube, some of you may have seen it, about what would happen if Microsoft were to redesign the packaging of iPod. Here you go. God, I love that. Because that's what happens in industry. And the bigger the industry, the more it happens. So you have a fight on your hands just trying to keep your vision intact. And so, to the final piece of advice, which is to ask, why not? I changed George Bernard Shaw here. You see things and you say why, but designers and creative people see things and ask why not. Companies go around all the time asking why. They spend their entire lives holding focus groups and things asking why instead of why not. We creative people have a duty to society to ask why not. We are the people who create visions and ideas and put them in front of people and say, why don't we do this? Why not try this? It's crucial to what we do. So why not, as we saw at the beginning, a kettle that you don't have to unplug to fill it or pour from it. The result, the world's first so-called cordless kettle. And I can tell you that if I had a royalty on this, I certainly wouldn't be talking to you now. I'd be out in a super yacht in the harbour. Why not a range of kitchen knives that ask not what a knife should be, but ask instead what a knife could be, which use zirconium ceramic as a blade material and carbon fiber filled plastic as a handle, which changed the paradigm for a knife. We created these about 12 years ago, before we had any, there were any unitary construction knives. Or why not, as we did for Casio, who asked a simple question. Actually, it wasn't a question, it was a, this guy said to us, we cannot sell digital watches to women. At the time, they had a range of 300 ladies' watches. They were all analog. And so we went out with our cameras into the streets of London and Paris, and we hired opinion-forming young women to carry out this research. And what they came back with from that knowledge gathering, they couldn't make any sense of, but we, really looking at things as designers do, could. And we extracted some things from that about what was happening with fashion at the time, about what kind of products they were using and wearing. And we went back to Casio and said, what you need is a G-Shock watch in a smaller size for ladies. And instead of black plastic, we had this translucent shock-resistant material, an interchangeable strap system so that they could change the straps. And to meet the G-Shock specification, we had to have these protectors on, which became a signature of this range of watches. They called it Baby G, and it went on to be their second biggest brand. So these are the first Baby G watches, which we did in, I don't know, in the 80s sometime. This tells you a lot, this one. This is Casio, who'd been making black watches for decades, saying, I think we need to have one black one. It's an interesting story because I never could figure out from my friend at Casio why he called it Baby G. It had nothing to do with us. But he was a, he's a very shrewd guy, Toshi, and he sold the idea to the Spice Girls that they should wear these new Baby G watches before they were really, really famous. And I think he had a crush on Baby Spice, and I think that's why he called it.